Masechet Kiddushin Daf Lamed Chet. We saw a machloket about whether Hadash applies everywhere in the world or only in Israel. In the Mishnah, Rabbi Eliezer Hagadol, that he is the Rabbi Akiva's teacher. Rabbi Akiva is a third generation Tana. Rabbi Eliezer Hagadol is the second generation Tana. That's important to keep clear because we're going to see other names soon. So Rabbi Eliezer says that Hadash applies everywhere in the world, and we explained his reasoning is that the word b'chol moshevotechem means everywhere in the world, as opposed to Tanakama that says moshevotechem means when you settle in the land of Israel, there and then does the law of Hadash and related laws apply. So now we're going to analyze this further. B'shlama leman damar moshav kol makom she'atem yoshevim mashma haynu dikhtiva yechalu me'abur ha'aris b'machorat ha'pesach. So we understand, makes sense, according to the one who says means any place, that's Rabbi Eliezer's opinion. Then we understand the pasuk that says when Bnei Yisrael came into the land of Israel during the time of Yahushua. So we're going to see in a few minutes. The pasuk says they entered into the land of Israel on the 10th of Nisan. And then they ate from the produce of the land, everything that was growing there, only after Pesach, only on the 16th. In other words, they did not eat from the produce of the land from the 10th until the 16th. Why? So right after that they did. Before that they did not eat. Why not? Because it was a Hadash. And it was a great grain that grew before the Korban HaOmer, which is on the 16th, one is prohibited to eat. So you see that they kept the law of Hadash even before they came and settled the land of Israel. So it takes more than a few days to settle in. You have to conquer and settle the land, according to the other opinion. So here it makes sense because the law of Hadash applies everywhere in all time. They would have done it in the desert. It's applicable outside Israel. So certainly those 6 days that they're in Israel, it applies. That's why they waited till the 16th. Alma akrub omer v'adar achul. First, they brought Korban HaOmer on the 16th. They had the Mishkan. They brought Korban HaOmer. And then they ate from the produce of the land. That's good. But according to the other opinion, it says Moshevotechem means after you conquer and settle the land. So they didn't conquer and settle the land. Let them eat right away on the 10th of Nisan, 11th of Nisan. As soon as they're in the land, they could start eating the produce. It's permitted because the law of Hadash does not yet apply. Good question. And the answer is, lahavu serichi. No, you're right, they could have eaten it, but they didn't need it because they already had the man that they had stored up. And so while it would be permitted to eat the produce, they didn't need to eat it yet, right? They're still, they just got there, they're setting up tents, you know, they have to go and buy grain, nothing, they didn't grow anything yet. So they're going to go, eventually they'll buy grain from the people that are there and they'll start reaping and all that, but they just didn't get a chance to do it and they didn't need it, but really it would have been allowed. So now we have to prove that the man lasted them that long. Dichtiv. Ubnei se lachilu taman arbaim shana ad bo'am el eres noshabet et haman achilu ad bo'am el kese eres kenaan. Pasuk in Shemot, that is doubled and it's a bit confusing because it says that Bnei Yisrael ate the man for 40 years until they got to settled land. That sounds like until they were within the land and settled, they were still eating man. But then the rest of the pasuk says, "Achilu ad bo'am el keses Kenan." They ate it until they got to the edge of the border of Eretz Kenan, meaning that they stopped at the edge, and once they got in, they were no longer eating it. So we have a contradiction. You can't be that they only stopped eating man when they were in the land, because it says the rest of the pasuk that they ate it until they were at the border. And you can't take the border one literally only, because it says that they were eating it until they settled in the land. So which one is it? So we can reconcile both parts of the pasuk by explaining that on the 7th of Adar, that's the day that Moshe died. On that day, the man also stopped coming down. But they had some stored up. even though you're not allowed to store up man when the wall is falling. Okay, but after it finished, then they were allowed. They stored up some man, and they were eating that man that was in their bags until the 16th of Nisan. So in other words, it lasted them through the rest of Adar, right, from the 7th until the end, and the first 16 days of Nisan. So that reconciles both halves of the pasuk. The man stopped when they were at the border before they entered Eretz Canaan. It's true, the man did stop there. So when it says until the border, yes, the man stopped there. But they continued eating it even until they got into the land, and even a few days while they were in the land. So that explains the other half of the pasuk, that they were eating it until they settled into the land. Good. So that's that. That explains why they just didn't need to eat the produce of the land, even though technically they could have eaten it before, even before the Omer, because the law of Hadash did not yet come into application. All right, now that we mentioned this eating of the man, we're going to mention another beraita about it. Tanya idach ubnei yisrael alchu taman 40 shana. V'chir 40 shana achilu, v'halo 40 shana chasir 30 yom achilu. The pasuk in Shemot says, ibnei yisrael ate man 40 years. Now, if we take 40 years literally, it has to be exactly 40 years. Well, it's not true. Was it 40 years? Because it was actually 40 years less 30 days that they ate. How so? They left Egypt on the 15th of Nisan. And then the man started falling on the 16th of Nisan. And the man started falling on the 16th of Iyar, 1 month later. So, and then they kept eating the man, as we just saw, until the 16th of Nisan, 40 years later. So if you see that it's 40 years minus a month, the first month that they first left Egypt, that they were not eating man. So how come it says 40 years if it's actually less than 40 years? You could answer it, maybe just rounding up. But we have a better answer. Rather, the cakes, the bread that they took out of Mitzrayim, it tasted like man. And so even though technically it didn't fall from the ground, it was already introduction. It was like man. And so that's why you could say it was a full 40 years. Good. Another braita about this chronology. Tanya idach. B'shiba ba'adar met Moshe, b'shiba ba'adar nolad. Famous midrash that Moshe died and was born on the same date, on the 7th of Adar. Doesn't say so in the Torah. So how do we derive this? Minayin she b'shiba ba'adar met, sh'nemar v'yam osham Moshe b'ed Hashem. So Pasuk Adem Devarim says there, right at the border before they entered into Israel, Moshe died. And also right there in Arvot Moab, before they entered, they mourned over, cried over him for 30 days. So there we go. There's definitely 30 days there. And the beginning of Yeshua says, okay, behold, Moshe died. And right after this, Hashem tells Yeshua, right now that he died, go and cross the Jordan. Point being that there was no time lapse in between. And Peshat, you could say maybe there was time lapse, they had to get things ready. But from the fact that it says all these things back to back, now that Moshe died, now go. So not the day that Moshe died, they cried for 30 days. So they weren't going to travel. It would be disrespectful. But now that 30 days passed, immediately they entered into the land. Now, Uchtiva Ibru Bekerav Machane Vesavu Et Ha'am Lemor, Hachinu Lachim Sedaki Bot Shalosh Eterim Tabru Et HaYarden. Now, they didn't actually go in that day that Hashem commanded Yahushua to go in, because they had to prepare the camp and command the people and said, prepare for 3 days because you're going to enter into the land. So they did prepare everything that they needed, the food for their journey, and they prepared for 3 days. So we have here 30 days that they mourned over him and 3 days that they prepared for their journey. And we know that they crossed over the Jordan on the 10th of Nisan. So if you take the 10th of Nisan, subtract 33 days, right? 30 days that they mourned, 3 days that they prepared, what do you get? The 7th of Nisan. So it's actually some simple math, and you can figure out that Moshe died on the 7th of Nisan, assuming that there was no other things that happened in between. How do you know Moshe also was born on the 7th of Adar? Also doesn't say that in the beginning of Shemot. שנאמר ויאמר להם בן 120 שנה אנוכי היום לא אוכל עוד לשאת ולבוא. Because in Moshe's speech, all the way at the end of his life, he says, I am 120 years old today, and I can no longer bring you out in, to war and bring you and take you back in. Right, I'm too old, I cannot lead you anymore. And he points to Yeshua. Now, why do you have to say I'm 120 years old today? You could have said, I'm 120 years old. And then we know he's 120 years old. So that teaches us that that was his birthday. Today, I turned 120. And this coincides with the teaching that HaKadosh Baruch Hu sits and completes the years of the righteous from day to day, month to month. In other words, someone's righteous, they get to have a complete life. And that means full years that they will live out the entire year on which they are destined to die. And so that's Moshe's birthday is also his death date, and that's how we learn Moshe's birthday. Good. Tanya, Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai Omer, Shalosh mitzvot nistavu yisrael b'nechnisatan la'aretz, v'nahagot ben ba'aretz ben b'chosa la'aretz. This braita teaches that according to the Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai, that's Rabbi Akiva's student, he's a fourth generation at Tana, and he says there are three mitzvot that were commanded to Israel when they entered the land, but even though they were commanded as they enter into the land, nevertheless, they apply both in Israel and outside of Israel. In other words, these are agricultural laws, but they do apply everywhere. They are, as we're going to see, Hadash, Kilayim, and Orla. Basically, Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai agrees with Rabbi Eliezer HaGadol in our Mishnah, according to the interpretation that he's Lechumra, that all these three apply everywhere. We're going to see it's actually for a different reason. The source is a bit different, but it's the same halacha. Vuadin she'in hagu. He learns it from a kavachomer. Ma hadash en isuro isur olam. Now, regarding hadash, it says explicitly, b'moshevotechem. And so therefore that means that Hadash applies everywhere. And then we learn the other two from a Kal Vachomer. Hadash is relatively lenient because it's not prohibited forever. Once the 16th comes, the 16th at night, nowadays we don't have Korban HaOmer. Nevertheless, we could eat Yashan. Because once the day of the 16th is over, so then all the new grain becomes permitted, the Hadash becomes Yashan. So you see, it's not prohibited forever. Second, any Isuro Isur Hana'ah, Hadash is not prohibited by Hana'ah. If you have new grain and you want to feed it to an animal or buy and sell it, that's fine, you just can't eat it. V'yeshetel Isuro. And also, there's a way to permit it. Even before the end of the day of the 16th, when if you have a Beit HaMikdash or Mishkan, then you can bring Korban HaOmer, and if you bring it at 11 a.m., then all the new grain is permitted from that time. So it's like something you can actively do to make it permitted even earlier. And yet, even though this is relatively lenient, Noheg Ben Baras Ben Bechus HaLa'aretz, it does apply in the land and outside the land of Israel, all the more so, kilayim, shi'isuran isur olam, v'isuran isur hana'ah, v'en heter li'isuran, en odin shinhagu ben ba'aris ben b'chus la'aris, kilayim, planting together grapes and wheat, other diverse kinds, where that is prohibited forever. If you grow that, and then that produce is prohibited forever, you can't get any benefit from it, and there's nothing that you can do to make it permitted, right? So that's the two things. There's no time that you will wait that it will automatically become permitted, and there's also nothing that you can do to make it permitted. So since this is more stringent, all the more so, it should apply in all places. V'adin la'ola b'shnayim, and the kavachomet also we can use for orla, even though we can only do it for two of these things. Well, number one, Orla is Isur Hana'ah, can't get benefit from it. So in that way, it's more stringent than Hadash. And also, Orla, while things that grow already in the first 3 years, those will be prohibited forever. So that's true. That's a Isur Olam. However, things that grow from the third year and on, Devai, you have to give to the Kohen, and after that is permitted. So, whereas Kilayim, it doesn't matter. There's years and years of growth. However long it grows, it's going to be prohibited forever. But Olah is permitted after 3 years. So, therefore, the Kavah Chomed works only on two out of the three grounds, but still, that's enough. And so that's how we learn that all these three are prohibited. So that's Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai has the same law as Rabbi Eliezer in the Mishnah, even though he's learning a Kavachomet in a different way than Rabbi Eliezer did. Fine. Now, Rabbi Elazar, the son of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, so he's now a fifth generation Tana. It's also to be Elazar, the one in Amishnah was to be Eliezer. The one in Amishnah was the second generation. This one is the fifth generation. So the different names and different generations. Just don't want you to be confused, because this Rabbi Elazar is going to disagree with his father, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. And Rabbi Elazar is going to say a completely different halacha as follows. Kol ha-misva she-nistavu Yisrael kodim k'nisatan la'aris, noheget ben ba'aris ben b'chusa la'aris, la'achar k'nisatan la'aris ena noheget Ela ba'aris. Any misvah that Israel was commanded to do before they got into the land, that is, will apply in the land and outside the land. Basically, anything that's not an agricultural law that applies to one's body, personal laws like tefillin, Shabbat, all those were what they were commanded and had to be done before they got into the land. So therefore, they apply everywhere. However, anything that was commanded only once they got into the land, agricultural related laws, they only apply in the land of Israel. Echutz min hashmatat kesafim v'shiluach habadim shafapish nistavu alehem lachar k'nisatan la'aris noheget ben ba'aris ben bechusa la'aris, except for two laws. Hashmatat kesafim, on the seventh year, at the end of the seventh year, loans are cancelled. And also the emancipation of slaves in the Yovel, right? So Heved Ivri goes free. And even though these were commanded after they got into the land of Israel, so therefore you might think that they only apply in the land of Israel. No, but this is true everywhere you live. No matter where you live, if you live in America and you give a loan, Shemitah comes, the loan is canceled. And if there were slaves today, the slaves would, Eved Ivri, no matter where you are, they would go free. Okay, so this is Rabbi Elazar, the son of Rabbi Shimon. But basically, see, in the first part of it, he's saying that any law that applies only in the land, only once you come into the land of Israel, applies only in the land of Israel. So that would mean that Hadash, Kilayim, Orla apply only in the land of Israel, according to him. Good. Now we ask, Hashmatat Kesafim, Chovat Hagufi. Wait a second, why are you telling me that canceling of loans applies everywhere, and this is an exception, right? But isn't this a personal obligation? This doesn't have to do with things that grow in the land. So this should be obvious that this applies both in the land of Israel and not in the land and outside the land of Israel. This should be included under la'achar k'nisatan la'aretz, and not noheget. That should be included rather in the first clause. Anything that was commanded before they got into the land, because not dependent on the land, applies everywhere. In other words, obvious that it should apply everywhere, because it's a personal obligation. It's not about things that grow. Why do you have to tell me this? La nisrecha ela lecha detanya. Detanya, Rabbi Omer, ze devar ha-shemitah shamot. B'shte ha-shemitot ha-kadu medaber, achat shemitat karka, ve'achat shemitat kesafim. Bizman she'ata meshamet karka, ata meshamet kesafim. Bizman she'iyata meshamet karka, iyata meshamet kesafim. No, he had to say it because of the following beraita, where Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi says that according to the Pasuk, this is the matter regarding Shemitah, and then it says Shamot, you should erase. Now, this is a double language. Why does it have this double language? Oh, because we're talking about two Shemitot. One is you have to let the land rest, not work the land. The other one is that loans get canceled, and so they linked to each other at a time when there is when the law of letting the land rest applies, then canceling loans also applies. When the law of releasing the land does not apply, so then the law of releasing loans also does not apply. Now, since in this derasha, these two laws, the one with the land and the one with the loans, are linked to each other in terms of time, right? When one applies, the other applies. When one doesn't, the other doesn't. According to some, Shemitah nowadays in Israel is only Drabanan. And so then that would mean, right, not Doraita. So that would mean that loans also would not be Doraita. So since over here they're linked in regarding time, I might have thought that they're also linked regarding space. And that the... and therefore the canceling of loans would apply only in Israel. So that's why Rabbi Elazar, the son of Rabbi Shimon, has to go out of his way and say, not so. The law of canceling loans applies everywhere. Good. Then we ask, well, if you do have this back-to-back hekesh, why don't you learn that they also are correlated in terms of space? That in a place where you don't work the land, also loans will be canceled. And in a place where you don't have Shemitah of the land, then loans are not canceled. And then really, loans would also only apply in the land of Israel. Because the Shemitah of Hashem has been proclaimed. So this is an extra, this is an inclusive term. And that means everywhere, even outside the land of Israel. And that is the Chiddush that Rabbi Elazar wanted to teach us. Now, the other item he mentioned that's an exception is Shiluach Avadim Chobat Hagufi. He said that Shiluach Avadim, sending away slaves, applies everywhere. But that's also a personal obligation, not related to the land. People don't grow out of the land. Well, this is talking about in the Yovel, when Eved Ivri goes free, and it says you'll declare a jubilee in the land, or freedom in the land. So I might have thought only in the land this applies, but if someone owns an Eved Ivri outside the land, maybe then it does not apply. Therefore, the added words yovel, it is a yovel. That's an inclusive term that says in all places, and that's what he wanted. That's what Rabbi Elazar wanted to teach us. Well, if you're going to include everywhere, then why does the Torah say it's a release only in the land? That's to limit in terms of time, not in terms of space. That when there is a time when the Yovel law applies in Israel, then the law of letting slaves go free applies also, and it applies everywhere. But if a time when Yovel does not apply in the land of Israel, like nowadays when we don't have a Sanhedrin to apply it, and the majority of Jews are not yet in the land of Israel, although perhaps they already are. We have to do another count soon. So then the laws of freeing slaves does not apply anywhere. Good. So that's the two laws, the two exceptions of Rabbi Elazar, the son of Rabbi Shimon. Next, Tenanatam Hadasha Sumina Torah Bechol Makom Or La Halacha Vakilay Medivrei Sofrim. This is a Mishnah in Masechet Or La that new grain is prohibited from the Torah that everybody knows, because that's is mentioned in the Torah. The Chiddush here is that it's prohibited in all places. Famously, the Chatam Sofer made a play on words over here. It says Hadash, anything new, any innovation is prohibited from the Torah. He said this when he was polemicizing against reform. He says they were changing things. So he says not everything new is prohibited. Okay. But this is the original context. It's a good play on words. And the point is that Chadash applies everywhere, even outside the land of Israel. Mideoraita. Okay, that's the most stringent one. Orla, however, is a halacha. We'll see what halacha means, but it's somewhere in between. Less than a full deoraita. Apply in outside land. In Israel, of course, it applies. Midoraita, outside the land of Israel, is only a halacha. Kilayim applies outside the land of Israel, only midivrei sofrim. So this Mishnah, you see, is an in-between, not quite as much as Rabbi Eliezer. Back in our Mishnah, that said all three are applicable, but not as lenient as Rabbi Elazar, the son of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, as that we just saw, but rather Hadash is Torah, the other is less. Now, what does this mean? My halacha, Amar Rav Yehuda Amar Shmuel halcheta medina. So Rav Yehuda, the student of Shmuel, living in Bavel, says it means it's a local halacha. Halacha means that it's certain places where Jews settled, they practiced Orla, but it's not across the board anywhere you are. It's not a deoraita. Whereas Ula Amar Rabbi Yochanan Halacha L'Moshe Misinai, Ula, the student of Rabbi Yochanan living in Eretz Yisrael, explained that the Mishnah, when the Mishnah says Halacha, means Halacha L'Moshe Misinai. That would apply everywhere and is more authoritative, right? This is sometimes it's like the same as a Doraita. Here we're going to see it's lower than a Doraita, but more than a Rabbanan. So whereas according to Shemuel, it's kind of like a Minhag. There's certain places that took us upon themselves as a kind of a Doraita, Rabbanan slash Minhag. So it's more lenient, although it's going to be something, you know, something more than a Divrei Sofrim, right? Divrei Sofrim is certainly Rabbanan. Even within Rabbanan, Divrei Sofrim is usually means something more more stringent than just Rabbanan. Okay, so we have to sort all this out. But the point is that Kilayim is the most lenient. Orla is medium. Within that medium, Rabbi Yochanan is going to say it's higher, closer to Doraita. Shemuel said, no, it's lower down, closer to Rabbanan. And Chadash is Doraita, totally everywhere. Now, Amar Le Ula L'Rav Yehuda. Ula from Eretz Yisrael tells Rav Yehuda, Bishlam Ale Didida Min Alacham Shem Sinai Hanu Deshane Lan Ben Sefek Orla L'Sefek Kilayim. He says, it makes sense according to me. I say that the word halacha in this Mishnah means halacham Shem Sinai, which is very serious. And that's why there is a difference between a cases of safek regarding Orla, where we're going to be machmir, and cases of safek regarding kilayim, where you could be mekel. Because that's the rule. Safek d'rabanan l'kula. Safek d'oraita, you have to be more machmir. And so halacha is going to be more machmir in Orla than in Kilayim. And here's where the Mishnah, where we see that in fact there is a difference between the two categories of Orla and Kilayim. Ditnan. Safek Orla ba'aris asur b'suria mutar b'chus al-aris yored v'lokech b'dbad shelo yir'enu loket. If you have something that you're not sure if it's Orla or not. In other words, you go to the grocery store and you see some fruit there, but you don't know if it came from a tree that was within its first 3 years or later. So you're not sure. If you're in the land of Israel, it's prohibited because that's midoraita in Israel. So any safek doraita lechumra. In Israel, you have to go make sure. You need a certificate, right, that someone was making sure, or you ask the farmer and make sure that the tree is more than 3 years old. In Surya, is permitted. This means permitted b'di'avad. If it was already picked, Surya is basically not part of Israel, but it was conquered by David, so it has a somewhat in-between status that you, if you think if it's a permitted in Syria, you may come to permit it also in the land of Israel. Therefore, in Syria, you can't go and ask and just buy it. You can't go and tell a farmer, hey, can you pick me fruit from your tree? That's Orla. But if you already got it and you're not sure where it came from, then it's permitted. So b'di'avad, you can go and take it. However, b'chutzal la'aretz, that has a more lenient status, more lenient than mutar. You can go, yored belokech, you can go to the non-Jewish owner of this tree and buy it from him. As long as you don't see him actually taking from an orla tree. So he has a farm out in the back, and he has his house. So you go to his house and you say, listen, I want to buy some fruit. He says, okay, I'll be back in a few minutes. Don't look out the window. Don't watch him take it. If you actually see him take it from trees that are within their first 3 years, well, then that's not good, because then you know for sure that it's prohibited. And it does apply everywhere at some level, right? This is we're talking about Orla here. So this is Ula says this makes sense according to me. This is a halacha, meaning halacha l'moshe misinai. So you can't if you know it's no good, then you can't have it. But as long as you introduce a safek, and you can even ask him to make a safek, that's the point here. He's going out to the back, and you don't know. I don't know if he's taking from these trees or those trees or what the status of the trees is. Don't ask, don't tell. And then you can buy it from him. Whereas in Syria, you can't do that. Only if he already went and picked it and is here, so he has it in his store, then you can get it. Okay, that is all the law regarding Orla in the Mishnah. And that's a little more stringent than Kilayim. V'ilu gabe Kilayim tenan, kerem hanatua yarak, v'yarak nimkar chutzalo, ba'aris asur, besuria mutar, bechutzal aris yored velochet, v'ba'at shelo yilkot be'yad. Mishnah says that if you have a vineyard and it's with vegetables planted in it, so that's Kilayim. And you have the vegetables that are being sold separately from the vineyard. So now we don't know if they came from this vineyard, or they came from another place that it was grown separately and it's permitted. So in the land of Israel, it's asur. So it's a zafek. This is certainly doraita in the land of Israel. So it's no good. And in Surya, it's permitted, meaning if he already has it in his store and I don't know where it came from, so then it's permitted because it's the rabbanan. Zafek rabbanan lekula. Although this is already done for you. So in Syria, only if it's already done, b'di'avad, then it's okay. And outside the land of Israel, where we're not going to mistake that for the land of Israel, so Syria is a little bit more stringent, that only b'di'avad. But outside the land of Israel, yored v'loket, b'lbad shelo yilkot b'yad, you can go to the non-Jew and gather it, as long as you don't do it with your own hand. In other words, the Jew shouldn't go and pick out the vegetables from the kilayim patch, but he can have the non-Jew do it, even though he sees him and knows he's doing it, and knows it comes from here. Still, as long as you're not doing it and the other non-Jew is doing it, then you can go and buy it. So you see that kilayim is more lenient than orla, right? In kilayim, you can watch the non-Jew picking from the kilayim, and you can still have it. Whereas regarding orla, you're not allowed to watch. You can create a sefek. You know, you go and take it. Don't tell me where you got it from. You can create a sefek. So there's a difference between them, and that makes sense according to orla, because he says that orla is a halacha m'shem Sinai, more stringent than kilayim, which is only midivre sofrim. So orla says, you see, I can explain this mishnah just fine. Ela ledidach. According to you, Rav Yehuda, in the name of Shemuel, where you say that halacha means that it's a local practice. So the local practice, that's a drabanan. So then the laws should be the same. Either both of the laws of the laws in both Mishnayot of Orla and Kilayim should say regarding both of them that you can go and buy it, but you can't watch the non-Jew take it. Right, so both of them should be like Orla, or both of them should be, you can go and gather it. You just can't do it with your hand, but you can be with him while he's gathering it. So both, it should be consistent. Whichever one you want to pick is fine. And so our answer is, Ha'amar le Shemuel Rav Anan, Tene oze veze yored velokech, oze veze yored veloket. Indeed, Shemuel told Rav Anan that the Mishnah should read one of these, one of the other, right? You have to make both Mishnayot, that Yored Velokech, you can go and buy it, as long as you don't watch and pick it, or read both Mishnayot as saying, you can even go and gather it with them, as long as you don't do it with your hand, and he does it. In fact, both laws are the same. So yes, that is his version of the Mishnah. And Mor Bere De Rabana Matne Le Lekula Ze Veze Yored Le Loket Vat Shelo Yilkot Beyad. Shemuel said, pick one or the other, right? And Mor, the son of Rabana, had the version of that's more lenient regard in both of them, that in both Kilayim and Orla, the Jew that's going to buy from the non-Jew can go with him and gather it and watch him gather it. As long as the Jew doesn't physically himself go and take it, it's permitted, because outside the land of Israel, it is the Orla and Kilayim is midrabanan. What you see is that the Gemara is not conclusive regarding Hadash. Is that Doraita or Drabanan? Rambam decides the halacha lemaasen. Shulchan Aruch follows this also, that Hadash, outside the land of Israel, is prohibited mid-deoraita, which is why Sephardim generally are more machmir regarding to make sure they have yashan flour everywhere outside the land of Israel. And Ashkenazim are less stringent, and say, well, perhaps one of the reasons one can be lenient is that if you follow the view that it's midrabanan outside the land of Israel, if it's rabanan, then you say sefek, as look, if I go to the store and I buy something, I don't know where it came from, I don't know if this was picked before the 16th of Nisan, of Tegrut, before the 16th of Nisan, or afterwards, and therefore, as long as it's a sefek, one can be lenient, right? But this makes a big difference whether one is careful to have only yashan flour outside the land of Israel or not will depend on whether one holds that hadash is prohibited midoraita or midrabanan outside the land of Israel. Baruch Adonai leolam. Amen v'amen.